वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन, दिस इज डॉक्टर संकेत चरखा फ्रॉम सावित्रीबाई फुले पुणे यूनिवर्सिटी सिंहगड इंस्टीट्यूट्स दिस साइड. वी आर स्टार्टिंग विद द सब्जेक्ट ऑफ इकोनॉमिक एनालिसिस ऑफ बिजनेस डिसीजन. एंड इन द अर्लियर और द फर्स्ट चैप्टर वी हैव अंडरस्टूड व्हाट इज मीड बाय इकोनॉमिक्स, व्हाट इज द कंसेप्ट ओरिजिनेशन एंड डेवलपमेंट ऑफ द टर्म ऑफ इकोनॉमिक्स. एंड फर्दर वी हैव अंडरस्टूड व्हाट आर द वेरियस ब्रांचेस ऑफ इकोनॉमिक्स. विद रिस्पेक्ट टू द मेजर कंसिडरेशन वी हैव सीन व्हाट इज मीन बाय मैक्रो इकोनॉमिक्स एंड व्हाट इज अ कंसेप्ट ऑफ माइक्रो इकोनॉमिक्स. Further, we have also dealt with the subject called as an managerial economics, which is a new branch of economics that has been inserted, and the definition that has been given by Adam Smith and Professor Lionel Robbins was also been undertaken for this study. Then also we have understood about the various theories that are applicable with respect to the economic study development. So the theories with respect to the Adam Smith's growth model, Maris and Maris growth organization model, all those theories we have also dealt with and we have understood or undertaken. The Williamson discretionary theory, the Maris growth model theory, and the Baumol's static and dynamic model theory. So what are the various factors that influence of the behavior of a particular individual, whether it is a factor of either managerial discretionary, a factors of skill sets, a factors of production, factors of land, labor, capital, enterprise, and resources, and so on. Also, we have studied or we have looked into the economist theory of the firm with respect to Salt and Mark behavioral theory that has been provided. Also, a brief overview of the profit maximization model that has been provided by Adam Smith and the firm's objective or the motive of the firm, whether it is a profit maximization or wealth maximization, that was also undertaken in the last chapter. Now, today we are starting with the second chapter of economics, that is utility and demand analysis. So what is meant by utility, what is the concept of demand, and how do we need to undertake or how do we need to understand or analyze the demand for a particular product? Demand analysis. Now, beginning with this particular chapter, the concept of demand. So, for understanding the concept of demand analysis or what is utility, we have to first understand or we have to first learn what is meant by demand. So, there are two definitions that have been provided by Benham and G.L. Thicketill, which means the first definition of Benham, it's the demand for anything at a given price is amount of it which will be bought for per unit at that particular price. So how do we define about demand for a particular product? It is specifically identified or it can be determined based on the purchasing power of an individual. So whenever I say I want to purchase gold, then I must have a purchasing power to purchase that particular gold. Now that particular purchasing power or the unit must also be very specific. That is, whenever I say that purchasing of 10 grams of gold, then accordingly my capability, my ability to purchase 10 grams of gold must be around 20,000, 50,000, 55,000, 60,000 and so on. Whenever I say I want to purchase a bistleri, that is a mineral water of a particular bottle of mineral water, then the costing of this particular product or this particular price or commodity is around from 15 rupees, 20 rupees, 30 rupees, 50 rupees and so on. So accordingly, my purchasing power should be associated with that particular product. And whenever I say I have the purchasing power to purchase that particular product, then we can say that there is a demand for that particular product. Now, for example, a particular labor or a particular person who is living on footpath. So that particular person, he does not have a capability to purchase either Mercedes, BMW or a particular flat which is costing rupees 1 crore. So accordingly, the particular person, according to his purchasing power, according to his income, he is looking for his demand, he is looking for his needs, and accordingly, he will be consuming only those products which are affordable, which are comfortable and which are within his own limits. Simultaneously, which will be bought per unit price. Now, demand analysis, what does it focuses? It focuses on per unit of product. Now here, whenever we say per unit of product or that particular specific price, then it is always related to one single commodity, that is purchase of 1 gram of gold, purchase of one flat, purchase of one Mercedes car, purchase of one product, purchase of one toothpaste and so on. So one single unit, it differs from person to person. A particular individual person who is staying on a particular PG room, he will be purchasing only one quantity. A particular family living together, that is father, mother, children and sister, they will be purchasing either 2 or 3 quantity. A particular family which is of a joint in nature, they will be purchasing 4 to 5 quantity. A particular organization wherein there are 10 to 15 employees, they may be purchasing 10 quantity. A particular large-scale organization having employee strength of 1,000 to 2,000, they will be purchasing 100 to 200 quantities. So in this case, what happened? The quantity differs from the number of participants, number of persons that are there into existence. So what happened? Your demand for that particular product is always changing as the number of persons, as the number of people increases. So based on that identification, we have to identify how many participants, how many consumers are that for the, are there for that particular product, and accordingly the particular product will be demanded. If I am individual living at my home, then accordingly for my individual basis there will be requirement of only one single unit. If there are more persons living with myself, then accordingly the requirement of that particular product will be in more number. Same case, it is also associated with the pricing factor. Now, a particular product that I am purchasing for. So at this stage, whenever I purchase one product, the price will be around 10 rupees, 20 rupees, depending on the what product I am purchasing. For example, purchasing a mineral water bottle. So for this case, I will be needing only 20 rupees. But if I want to purchase 50 liters of water, if I want to purchase 10 bottles of mineral water, then accordingly, the price, the quantity, the everything product commodity changes, and accordingly, the demand for the product changes depending on the individual. Now, the second definition that has been given by G.L. Thicketel, the demand for any commodity is the amount that will be bought at any given price per unit of time. So what is the demand for any commodity is the amount that will be bought. So what is the amount? The amount is specific quantity that we are purchasing. So whenever I say that I want to purchase 1 liter, 1 kg, 2 kg, 5 kg, 10 kg, that is the amount of quantity that has been bought, and that particular quantity is associated with a given unit per price of fine per unit of time. So accordingly, per quantity basis, the price also changes. When now, for example, if I want to purchase wheat, the wheat per kg may be around 30 rupees, 35 rupees per kg. The rate for the rice for the rate per unit per kg may be different. You may get a price of rupees 12 kg also, 15 kg also, 50 rupees kg per also, and 120 rupees per kg rice also we get. So accordingly, the demand for a particular product depends on the quantity that you are demanding, and depending also on the quality of the product that you are expecting or you are prospecting to buy. So two definitions that has been provided with respect to Benham and G.L. Thicketel. Now, what does the effective demand require? So in order to identify if whether your demand is effective or not effective, first consideration that we need to understand is the desire that a particular individual has. So unless and until you have a certain desire, now desire means specifically means your ichcha. So unless and until there is a thirst, there is a desire, there is a willingness to purchase, we cannot say that there is a demand for that particular product. So desire in the sense, if you are having a certain desire for purchasing, for consuming, for eating something, then only you will be going to that particular location and then you will be purchasing that particular product. So always the purchasing power of an individual is always backed by a desire. So a desire in the sense, now this particular desire may come from any point of time. That is, you may watch an advertisement, you may listen from a particular people, you may just have your temptation, you may just have a certain motivation, and so on. So based on those particular concerns, the desire may be developed, and whenever the particular desire has been developed, the person reaches out to the different stores, different outlets, and accordingly the product is been demanded. Means to purchase. Now, what are the various means to purchase? That is the consideration about how you acquire those particular products. So acquisition of those particular products may be from different sources. You may manual. Now, for example, if you are hungry, now for whenever we say that you are hungry, now there are various options for you. That is, you may cook the food at your home, you may call a certain person to cook for yourself, you may either go out for a particular restaurant, you may go out for a certain mall, or you may purchase the ready-made packaged foods, and so on. So means to purchase. So in order to satisfy your demand, so what was your demand? Your demand was to satisfy your hunger. So satisfaction of hunger, there are 4 to 5 options in which your hunger can be satisfied. Another case, for example, if you want to travel from one place to another place, that is, you want to travel from Mumbai to Delhi. So for traveling from Mumbai to Delhi, there are various options. That is, you may go via road also, you may go via rail also, you may go via airways also, or you may build a seaport also. So accordingly, various ways are available for you. So means to purchase. Now here, what is your demand? Now, if you're willing that I want to go by a certain specific mode, then and a specific mode, which is for example of a road, and accordingly that particular road purpose, if you are objecting for, then for this particular concern, you have various options. Whether you go whether you want to go by walking, whether you want to go by cycling, whether you go on whether you want to go by 2-wheeler, 4-wheeler, and so on. For example, the option that you choose, that you want to go by 4-wheeler. So under 4-wheeler also, you have different categories, different brands of vehicle that is made available. So what are the various means to purchase? How will you able to satisfy this particular demand? What is your demand? Your demand is to move from one place to another place, that is from Mumbai to Delhi, and via roadways. So in this way, the various means for purchases are available for you. Now, various brands, you may go for Maruti, you may go for Tata, you may go for Hyundai, you may go for Mercedes, BMW, and so on. So various brands of products are available for you. And from those particular brands, you may pick one product. For example, if one brand is been picked, then accordingly under that particular brand also you have various different products. So what we are doing, we are going from a macro perspective to a micro perspective. So always demand analysis focuses on a micro perspective. And in the definition that is given by Benham specifically focuses. Benham is a European economist. He specifically focuses on a particular concept of an microeconomic level. That is for a per unit of price and a per single unit of per single quantity of product that has been demanded. And in the case of means to purchase, you may not purchase 10 vehicles to travel from Mumbai to Delhi. You will need only one vehicle wherein you can transport, wherein you can travel from one place to another place. So in this case, what we are doing, from going from a macro perspective, you are coming to a micro perspective and you're selecting only one single unit of product. Willingness to use. Now at this stage, unless and until there is a willingness, that is if you are purchasing that particular product, then at the same point of time, what you have to do, you have to use that particular product also. So for now, at this stage, what happened, the consumption function. So whenever we understood the concept of GDP, that is gross domestic product, and GNP, gross national product, there is a major concept of import and export. So while calculation of GDP, what do we understand? C plus I plus G plus X minus M. Now at this stage, the consumption pattern of a particular individual also focuses at the larger scale. So unless and until the product has been consumed, unless and until the product has been used, we cannot come to a certain conclusion whether the desire has been fulfilled or not fulfilled. Now what was your desire? Your desire was to travel from one place to another place. That is, you want to travel from Mumbai to Delhi and you want to travel via roadways. In that particular roadways, you want the option of four-wheeler, and in that particular option of four-wheeler, you have purchased a car of Hyundai. Now, this particular car that you have purchased of Hyundai, whether that particular product that you have traveled or whether that product that you have purchased, was your satisfaction level up to a mark? Whether the satisfaction level was 40%, 60%, 80%, 100%, and so on. If the satisfaction is level is 0%, then we can say that your desire is not fulfilled. Why? Because your destination that you are reaching, it will be very uncomfortable, and the work that you are going for to work, the work that you are going to do for, will not be done successfully and effectively. So in this case, the demand is been associated with your desire. That is why you are purchasing this particular product. What is the need for purchasing this particular product, and what are the various options that are available for you to purchase this particular product? And lastly, willingness. So how was your willingness, whether the purpose, objective or motive of purchasing that particular product has been achieved or it is not achieved. So this is the concept, the basic introduction of understanding what is a demand and how do you analyze a demand. So going from a macro perspective to a micro perspective. Now, what are the various objectives of demand analysis? So before we deal with the different major considerations of the demand analysis, we have to understand why demand analysis is undertaken. So the major objectives of demand analysis. First thing, we have to forecast the demand. So first objective of the demand analysis is to demand up or to forecasting of a particular demand. That is, in order to identify what number of products, what number of customers, or what number of sales can be undertaken. So forecasting of a demand is of very essential importance to understand how many production has to be undertaken. So demand forecasting, for example, if I want to manufacture or purchase or sell a particular product. So before selling a particular product, what will I do? I will identify how many number of customers are available for me. And based on the availability or the demand for that particular product, accordingly, we will start manufacturing that particular product. So any product that has been launched into a particular market, before launching that particular product or before manufacturing that particular product, what do we do? We forecast. Now, forecasting is looking into future. That is when, in actual sense, the product will be into market, when the product will be offered to the customers, whether the customer will purchase to it or not, or whether if the customers are purchasing, why they are purchasing, if they are not purchasing, why they are not purchasing, and if they are purchasing, what is the outcome of that particular product. So here, willingness to use. So whether the product that was been offered for you, what satisfaction you have level you have achieved or you have attained from that particular product. So in this case, we have to understand about forecasting of that particular product of in terms of demanding. Now this particular demand may be on the basis of your price or in the basis of your quantity. Now, in the basis of pricing, if the particular product that you are going to manufacture, that you are going to launch into this particular market, the market value of that particular product is, for example, is rupees 1 lakh. But you are introducing this particular product for rupees 90,000, or you are introducing this particular product for rupees 2 lakhs. So in this case, the customer मे परचेज और मे नॉट परचेज. सो डिपेंडिंग ऑन दी फीचर्स ऑफ योर रिस्पेक्टिव प्रोडक्ट, इफ देर आर मोर फीचर्स, एडिशनल फीचर्स टू योर प्रोडक्ट, द कस्टमर मे परचेज योर प्रोडक्ट प्रोडक्ट एट रुपीज 2 lakhs ऑल्सो. एंड इफ देर आर नो फीचर्स विद योर प्रोडक्ट, द कस्टमर विल नॉट परचेज एट 50,000 ऑल्सो. सो वेदर द प्राइज इज इंक्रीज और वेदर द प्राइज इज डिक्रीज और इफ द प्राइज इज केप्ट एज सेम, दैट इज इफ द प्राइज द मार्केट वैल्यूएशन ऑफ दैट पर्टिकुलर प्रोडक्ट इज रुपीज 1 lakh एंड अकॉर्डिंगली यू हैव ऑफर्ड दैट पर्टिकुलर प्रोडक्ट फॉर रुपीज 1 lakh सेम प्राइजिंग. So in this case also we have to identify at the par, premium or discount pricing what product will be purchased, whether the product will be purchased or whether it will not be purchased in terms of quantity. So by the geographical identification, with the terms of the geographical identification we have to also see that what amount of quantity of product that will be demanded over a period of time. So quantity of product, so a particular customer, depending on his employee, depending on his family, depending on the societal structure, depending on his standard of living, what happen, he may purchase different quantity of that particular product also. I may have a certain capability to purchase one product, you may have a certain capability of to purchase 5 products, a certain X person may have a capability to purchase 10 products. So in this way, the demand forecasting in terms of quantitative basis also has to be done. Qualitative basis, depending on the differentiation between the product of that you are manufacturing and that you are offering to the customers in terms of the competitors. So whatever product that you are launching for, it must be always distinct from the competitors or the actual product that is available into the market. So in this case, the demand forecasting also plays a very important role in terms of identification of the qualitative, quantitative and monetary factors, that is the pricing factors of that particular product that has been associated that you are going to offer to the consumers. Second objective of demand analysis is the concept of production planning. Now, production planning here in terms is in this case specifically means with the actual manufacturing activity of the goods that you are doing for. So once you have identified what is the demand for this particular product, once you have forecasted that the product that I am launching for this particular product, there will be 1,000 quantity or 1 lakh of quantity that will be demanded. The price of this particular product will be rupees 1 lakh per goods or the per product. In this way, what we have done, we have set a certain target, we have set a certain parameter, and according to this concern, what do we do? We start our actual manufacturing or we start our actual production activity. Now, whenever we start our production activity, what we have to see, major consideration that is required at this stage is the factors of production. So what are the various factors of production? That is land, labor, capital, enterprise, and resources. So planning of all the factors of production at this stage, particular at this stage, is very essential. So unless and until your factors of production are quite stable, if they are quite available in a very freedom, in a competitive way, your production activity cannot be conducted in an effective way. So we have to understand what are the various factors of production that have been associated, whether the factors of production are being in a balanced structure or not, and if they are not in a balanced structure, how you can maintain a balance at this particular stage. So planning of all the production activity, from where the raw material will be sourced out, from where the other chemicals, components, land resources, labor resources, capital resources will be identified, how they will be utilized, all these activities have to be sourced out, all these activities have to be planned accordingly, and then we have to actually go for manufacturing. When all these particular components have been assembled together, then the particular manufacturer starts manufacturing this particular product. Now, once the manufacturing of the product has been undertaken, your job does not end at that particular stage. What we have to do, you have to identify the distribution chain. That is, ultimately, what is your target? That your target is to sell or your target is to deliver a particular product to the customer. So in order to deliver the product to the customer, what do we have to see for? How the product will be reaching to that level or to that particular end point. So the distribution chain with respect to the manufacturer, wholesaler, dealer, supplier, retailer, and ultimately the retailer, that is the point of sale wherever the particular thing or the product can be made for point of sale. So in this case, production planning with respect to the monetary perspective, qualitative perspectives, and factors of production that have been associated. Next concern we have is the concept of sales forecasting. Now, sales forecasting specifically means your demand may be different, but your actual sales may be different. Now, take an example of Tata Nano. Now, understanding the economics behind Tata Nano. So at this stage, we have a certain case study that has been associated with respect to Tata Nano, which specifically focuses about how the economics of the company changes over a period of time. Now, take a certain situation wherein in the year 2009 or 2008, when Mr. Ratan Tata declared that he is going to launch a particular vehicle, a four-wheeler vehicle, which will be costing rupees 1 lakh. Now, understanding or what was his target base? He was targeting a certain classes of people, that is the middle class people, and what he was expecting that middle class people can afford a particular four wheeler of rupees 1 lakh, and accordingly he want to see a middle class people for traveling in a four wheeler. So our demand forecasting was different, but in actual, when production planning came into existence, the price of the product, the value of that particular product started to increase. Now sales forecasting, the demand forecasting that was been associated, that was done for this particular product, was at least 10 crore people or at least 50 crores of people will be purchasing this particular car, that is Tata Nano. But in actual sense, what happened when the production planning was came into existence, when actual manufacturing activity of this particular product was started to commence, the sales forecasting also collapsed simultaneously. Why? Because there was change in the production planning, or there was change in the factors of production that was been associated during the course of time. That is, when the product was being launched in the year 2008 and 2009, the actual product was readily available by the year 2011. Now, a duration of 2 to 2.5 years has been spent on. That is 2008 and 9, 10 and 11. So around 2.5 to 3 years was into existence. And during this course of time, what happened? The components, the production planning, the rate of land increase, the rate of labor increase, the rate of raw material increase, the rate of steel, the rate of automobile industry, everything, the rate of fuel, everything started to increase. Now, when there is a continuous inflation into this particular economy, what happened? The product pricing, that is the total product, that is total cost of that particular product also increases. So what we have seen, a certain components with respect to total cost, average cost, total revenue and marginal revenue. So understanding this particular concept with respect to total cost, the total cost may be associated with the all the assembly or all the components that have been associated with that particular product. Accordingly, marginal revenue, what company is earning, or what is the total revenue from the total product that has been manufactured, the company that is getting the revenue from this particular concern may be called as in total revenue. But a per single product quantity, per single selling of this particular product, the marginal revenue was decreasing. So what was the theory that was being specifically mentioning? The theory specifically focuses on the concept of balance between the total revenue and marginal revenue. So whenever the marginal revenue increases, what are the various drawbacks? What are the various pros and cons? And whenever there is a decrease in the marginal revenue or the total revenue, what are the various pros and cons on the business concern? So in this case, the sales forecasting also differs. Now, sales forecasting, the forecast that was being made by Tata Nano, it specifically mentions that at least 10 crore of people will be purchasing the Tata Nano car. But in actual sense, what happened? Only 10 lakhs of people have purchased the Tata Nano car. So look at the difference. Where is 10 lakhs and where is 10 crore? So there is a huge difference of amount of around 9.10 crore. And accordingly, the company collapsed and accordingly, the product was failed. Why the product was failed? Because there was failure in the demand for forecasting, there was failure in the production planning, there was failure in the sales forecasting, and so on. So in this case, at every stage, we have to identify how the demand can be estimated, if it has been estimated, whether that particular demand is for a perfect product or an imperfect market, what type of market product that we are looking for, and so on. Sales forecasting, now depending on the change in the habit, change in the level of income, change in the standard of living, the demand for this particular product may change over a period of time. A customer may agree for purchasing a particular product as on today, but tomorrow if he loses his job, tomorrow if there is no income available, he may not purchase your product. Today, a particular customer may say you that I may purchase one quantity, but tomorrow if his standard of level increases, if his income level increases, he may purchase 10 quantity of products. So sales forecasting has to also be very effective. Only then the demand analysis can be done in an effective way. So what is the pattern of individual? What is the pattern of saving? What is the pattern of expenditure? And so on, everything has to be identified. And then the sales forecasting, that is, the sales forecasting is completely dependent on the manufacturing activity, and manufacturing activity can be very effective only when the demand for the forecast, demand forecasting is done effectively. Next concept, control on the business factors. So business factors that have been associated with your business are the internal factors and the external factors. Internal factor, that is within the organization, what are the various changes, what are the various outlook that has been there into existence, and how your business internally is been changing. Whether all the activity that have been conducted in the department are conducted very effectively, very fluently, and there is proper coordination between all the departments. So manufacturing department, raw material department, stockist department, wholesaling department, marketing department, sales and distribution department, finance department, operations department, and so on. So all these departments must have a proper coordination, and only then the business activities of the internal organization can be done very effectively. your proper stability in the internal management, that is your top level management, middle level management and low level management. All the participants or the components of the employees must be very effective, and then only we can say that our organization is having a healthy internal environment. External environment with respect to the government, the various business factors, the various competitors, the various investors, traders, stockists, banks, and so on. So the various participants or the stakeholders who are available for your particular business, they also have a certain stake about how a particular product or how a particular demand can be identified and whether the business is flourishing or not. So in this case, we have to understand or we have to see about what are the various business factors that have been associated, and when these business factors have been associated, whether they have been conducted effectively or not. So if they are conducted very effectively, then whether the performance of the internal management and the external management and management, whether it is going effectively in a balanced way and how it is benefiting our organization as a whole. Inventory or stock control. Now, inventory or stock control is directly related with the production planning concept. So, production planning concept specifically focuses on the availability of raw material. Inventory means specifically your raw material or the stock. That is, you must have heard in terms of accounting, that is stock or the opening stock and closing stock. The stock that is available in your balance sheet, which is having either opening value or a closing value. So stock in trade that is available, the goods that have been available at the inventory level, which have been either used for the day-to-day consumption or the long-term consumption. So you may have a stock which can be used at the immediate basis, or you may have a certain stock which may be used after a certain point of time. So proper maintenance of inventory, at what time, at what place, and at what quantity the inventory will be required, and how do you need to maintain the inventory or the stock of this particular goods and services that have been into existence. So for proper or effective production concern, we have to see that you have a proper availability of raw material. So if raw material is available into your warehouse or the particular godown, then only the economic activity, that is, what is that economic activity? Economic activity of manufacturing, economic activity of delivering or supplying the goods to the particular consumer will be effective, and only then the entire cycle will be complete and going in a smooth way. So proper control on inventory, proper control on stock has to be there into existence, and then only the demand analysis objective can be achieved. Short-term and long-term growth and investment. So simultaneously, a particular trader or a particular company has to also look for what is the concept of, or what is the concern of short-term and long-term growth that is there or that has been associated. Short-term growth, now what is the objectives and aims of that particular company in terms of short-term level? So short-term, what they are looking for, whether they are achieving or whether they are looking for the profit maximization or wealth maximization, what is the market position of this particular company, whether it is a regular product, whether it is a traded product, whether it is a premium product, or whether it is a seasonal product. So based on the type of your product also, you have to identify what growth rate will be there for this particular product, and accordingly, what amount of quantity will be demanded. Now, based on the growth that is there for your product, what happened? We have to source out for the investment that is there into existence. So investment with respect to investment of the short-term level and the long-term level. Short-term investment is also is always called as a working capital, and long-term investment is always associated with the amount of debt that you are going for. So a debt may be identified from the various concerns with respect to the banks, financial institutions, government institutions, private lenders, money lenders, and so on. So there are various options available into the market wherein the amount of the fund can be raised, and accordingly, the long-term achievement of the long-term investment factors can be associated. Short-term factors. Now, for the short-term availability of the funds or the amount that has been required, you may source out from your internal management, you may source out from a bank, you may source out from the short-term money lenders, and so on. So, a short-term requirement of the funds can be associated, can be linked with the various performance associations, and accordingly, from the financial institutions that are made available, you can correlate between how the organization is growing and how, for this growth of the organization, the availability of finance, availability of investments can be made or can be made available. And last perspective is the concept of economic planning. The concept of economic planning specifically focuses on the overall growth rate of that particular economy. The overall growth rate of that particular economy, it's specifically mentioning about how the economy is growing. That is, whether the economic growth rate of that particular economy is at 1%, 2%, 5%, 6%, 8%, and 10%. What is the GDP of that particular economy? What is the GNP? What is the purchasing power? What is the income level? How is the standard of living? And so on. So, economic planning. Economic planning with respect to the monetary policy, fiscal policy, trade policy, import-export policy, and so on. So, all these are the various factors with which you have to understand, with which you have to take into concern about how the economy is growing. Now, economy. Now, how economy has been formed? Economy is formed with the various components or the participants of the different organizations, manufacturers, traders, suppliers, dealers, and so on. So, when all the components come together, they work together, then we can say that overall economy is growing. Only when one sector, for example, if only manufacturing sector is growing, we cannot say that economy is in a good position. All the sector, then all the, there are n number of sectors available into a particular industry, that is steel industry, iron industry, manufacturing industry, auto industry, textile industry, and so on. So based on this particular concern, the economic planning is can be very successful, can be very profit making for the entire organization or for the entire country, whenever only when the profit maximization, sales maximization, wealth maximization objective is been achieved and the economy is going in an effective way. Okay, any difficulty at this stage? This was the concept of demand analysis. Now we are moving with the concept of specific demand. If you have any difficulty, you can please unmute yourself and ask the questions. Okay, moving for the no questions. Now identifying what are the various types of demand. So earlier what we were seeing, we were understanding what is the meaning of demand and what are the various objectives of demand that has to be identified or that has to be associated, that has to be fulfilled by a particular organization or by a particular industry or by a particular manufacturing firm or a company. So now we'll look at a certain perspective about what are the various different types of demand that have been associated and how the demand can be identified. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So different 8 types of demand are there into existence. Now let's look one by one. First demand, that is individual or market demand. So individual or market demand is a particular demand wherein a particular product that has been demanded is for a single product or a single commodity which has been offered, which has been demanded by an individual product. Now take an example. For example, you want to purchase a mineral water bottle. Now whenever you say that I want to purchase a mineral water bottle, then you will be purchasing the bottle for just yourself or for your some few members, that is either one people or two people. So if a particular product has been purchased for a single person or more than that is maximum of 2 to 3 people, then that particular product that has been demanded is called as an individual demand or a particular market demand. Market demand, the particular product which is available in a retail market wherein only one or maximum of 1 to 2 or maximum of 3 people will be purchasing that particular product will be called as a concept of individual demand or a concept of market demand. Second perspective, firm or industry demand. Now firm or industry demand is a particular concern wherein at this stage if a particular product has been demanded by a certain firm, by a certain company, by a certain organization, by a certain association, then that particular type of demand is called as an firm demand or an industry demand. So firm, for example, take an example of Sinagar Institutes or a particular company that is HCL, Hindustan Computers Limited, or TCS, Tata Consultancy Services. Now this particular firm, now at this particular stage, what happened? There will be demand for a different products. Now identify the type of demand and type of demand under the category of firm or industry demand. Now Sinagar Institutes forms under the category of education industry, and under this education industry, what will be the demand for this particular product? We may require file, we may require furniture, we may require for fixtures, we may require chairs, we may require classroom, we may require blackboard, we may require markers and so on, chalk, dusters and so on. There are many products that have been required in education industry, but what we are doing, we are not purchasing one single quantity or 2 or 3 quantity, we are purchasing the quantity in bulk. That is the quantity that has been purchased. For example, purchasing of a particular printer machine, purchasing for different computers. Now TCS, what TCS will do, when TCS is purchasing a certain goods and services or commodity, they are not buying 1 or 2 quantity. They will be buying 10 quantity, 50 quantity, 100 quantities, 200 quantities, and so on. Same case in case of Sinagar Institute, when we are purchasing markers, dusters, pen, pages, computers, printers, desktops, and so on, what we are doing, we are purchasing the quantity of 100, 200, 500, and so on. Why? Because the need, the demand for this particular product is in maximum number. So in this case, as an individual, that is for the example, that is Mr. Sanket needs a particular laptop, what he will do, he will purchase only one single laptop. He will not need 5 laptops at the same point of time. But if I want to purchase a laptop for my firm, if I want to gift it to my employees, or if I want to give a certain services for my respective employees or my respective customers, then I'll be purchasing 10 laptops, 20 laptops, and so on. So in this case, depending on what is your nature of purchase. So if you are purchasing for your individual self, then the purchase of laptop will be just one. If you are purchasing for your company, then the purchasing quantity may increase. It may be around 10 or 20. So third type of demand may be an autonomous or derived demand. Now, what is the concept of autonomous or derived demand? Wherein a particular demand which has been generated over a period of time. So at initial stage, you don't have the requirement of this particular product, but after a point of time, after the several stage, this particular demand may be generated, this particular demand may be created, and based on the creation, based on the need, the autonomous or the derived demand is being created. Now, for example, give you an example. For example, whenever there was a situation of COVID-19, in the earlier phase, what happened? There was no more demand for a earphone. There was no more demand for a smartphones. There was no much demand for your Bluetooth devices. There was no much demand for the data pack that was being required. But as soon as the COVID-19 situation came into existence, what happened? The demand has been derived. Everyone wants to switch online. Everyone wants to conduct their activities. Everyone wants to conduct or they want to perform their activities or they have to complete the job online mode. And accordingly, due to this concern, what happened? There has been a derived demand for purchasing of Bluetooth. There has been a demand for purchasing of the headphones, earphones, wireless phones, smartphones, and so on. So in this way, what happened? The demand has been derived over a period of time. That is, before 2019, there was no demand for this particular product. But after 2020, the demand has been increased or the demand has been derived. Again, in the year 2022, when everything has been normal, when physical classes will be into existence, what happened? These particular products will not be into demand and you may switch from the physical classroom. So in this case, what happened? The demand is been derived. The demand has been created for an autonomous level. That is, for a very specific level. After a specific period point of time, the demand may be achieved and accordingly, the product may not be used. Another example, that is an example of an autonomous or a derived demand. For example, you are a student. Now, whenever you were a student, that is at 10th standard, 12th standard, at the graduation level, you was not needing laptop or a particular desktop at your home. But today, whenever you have taken admission for your MBA, what happened? There are various assignments given for you. There are various presentations given for you. There are various activities that you have to do. There are various emails. There are various job activities that you have to conduct either on your laptops or either on your desktop that you are going for. So at this stage, whenever you approached your MBA course, whenever you approach the MBA curriculum, now, for example, there are two friends. One friend has taken admission to MBA, second friend is doing the job and he's not, or a third friend is not doing anything. Now, at this stage, what will be the derived demand? The first friend who has taken admission for MBA, he is having a derived demand for a purchasing of laptop. Why? Because his need has been created, his demand has been created, his job has created, his activities has derived in such a way that he is in need of that particular laptop and he will be purchasing the laptop. The second person has got the job and accordingly his job is specifically related with it, not with the laptop, but he needs a certain concern wherein he has to sit on a particular table, and accordingly sitting on that particular table he needs to do his activities on the desktop only. So at this stage, what happened? He will be in a need, or his autonomous or derived demand will be specifically for a particular product which is of a desktop nature. Another person, the third person or the third friend, he is not doing anything. So at this stage, there will be no demand for this particular product or a particular commodity that he is looking for. So autonomous demand, what he will be needing for? He'll not be needing either laptop, he will not be needing either desktop, and accordingly, he will be just spending his time as and when it has been required. So individual demand, that is for your individual need, individual requirement, the firm demand for the respective firm, for a respective industry, for a respective company, and so on. Autonomous or a demand which has been derived, which has been created over a period of time, and as and when the time changes, as and when the need changes, you purchase that particular product, you go to attempt to purchase that particular product, you use that particular product, and when the need arises or when the need has been fulfilled, you stop the usage of that particular product. Another type of demand, that is for durable goods and non-durable goods. So there are different types of goods that have been required over a period of time, and those particular goods have been categorized under two categories. What are the two categories? Durable product and non-durable product. Now, for example, purchasing a refrigerator, purchasing the vehicle, purchasing a washing machine, purchasing or interior decoration of your firm, purchasing the different blankets, purchasing the clothes and so on, or the purchasing of food articles. Now, we don't go to a particular mall and we daily purchase washing machine, refrigerator and so on. So you have to categorize which is a durable product and which is a non-durable product, which is perishable product, which is non-perishable product. So based on the differentiation or the type of the product, perishability and non-perishability, durability or non-durability, we try to purchase this particular product. Accordingly, the type of this particular demand. Now, purchasing of refrigerator. You may purchase a refrigerator once in a year, twice a year, or once in a 3 year, once in a 5 years, and so on. Whereas in case of food commodity or the food consumable product, you may need to consume the foods on a daily basis, and accordingly, the need for this particular product is for on a daily basis or a minute basis, hourly basis, and so on. So in this case, we have to identify which type of product we are looking for, whether it is a durable, non-durable, perishable, non-perishable, and so on. Short-term or long-term product. Short-term or long-term product are specifically associated with the specific time of duration. Short-term product, which has been specifically used for maximum of 1 month, and the product which has been used for the period of which is for the more than 1 month or more than 1 year, that particular product or that particular type of demand may be called as a short-term demand or a long-term demand. Now, for example, purchasing of a umbrella. Now, purchasing of a particular umbrella may be for just a very short period of time. That is, you may purchase an umbrella for just only 4 months. That is from June to September, only when there is a rainy season. Long-term product. Now, if you want to purchase clothes, same. The umbrella is a type of a cloth, and a particular cloth, clothes that you're purchasing is also a type of cloth. But we are using certain different types of clothes for a different occasional, different functions, and for several point of time, we wear different types of clothes. So accordingly, long-term basis, a certain product or a certain blanket. We do not change a blanket very often. That is for every month or for every season and for every so on, and the blanket remains the same. So in this case, the short-term period, a particular product which is used for a very short term and the particular product which is used for a very long-term period. So based on the duration, based on the time factor also, the type of demand changes or the type of demand differs. Joint or composite demand. The concept of joint or composite demand is a particular concern wherein one product is dependent on other products. So in this case, what we have to understand, the joint or the composite demand is always associated with different types of products or different type of commodity, depending on the need and requirement of that particular individual. Now, whenever you go to purchase a cell phone, now whenever we are going to purchase a cell phone, what we are doing for or what we are asking, give us that is the we ask to that particular retailer whether we'll get charger with this particular phone or not. Now, when if you are purchasing a cell phone, it is a mandate, it is a requirement that at the time of purchase, the battery may be full, that is 100%. But over a period of time, what you have to do, automatically the battery drains, that is after your consumption. And accordingly, whenever the battery comes to zero level or 1% or zero level, you have to again recharge your cell phone, that is recharge your battery, and according and then the product can be used. Otherwise, the product, that is the cell phone, can be used. Otherwise, the cell phone cannot be used. So here, joint or composite demand. What was your basic product? Your basic product was purchase of cell phone, but jointly which product is associated? The joint product that has been associated with the cell phone is the charger. So at this stage, a joint product, that is without this particular product, the other product cannot perform, the other product cannot be used. And in order to use this particular product, thus another substitute or the another complementary product is available at this particular stage. Another example, now if you are purchasing a particular bottle. Now, whenever we purchase a mineral water bottle, what happened at the same point of time, he does not give you a water. What he will do, he will provide you the cap of that particular bottle. He will provide the particular packaging of that particular bottle. The bottle will be in a round shape. It will be properly packed. It will be properly sealed. The seal will be available. The cap will be available. And the cap will also be sealed. And only then the bottle is given for you. Now, at this stage, what was your demand? Your demand was only for mineral water and it must be packed. So in this case, what we are doing only at the same point of time, there is a joint demand. So joint demand is a particular concern wherein in terms of bottle that has been provided along with the bottle, the cap is also been provided. The cover is also been provided. The packaging also been is also been provided and the seal also is been provided. So a joint or composite demand with respect to the product. Another product, for example, when the product is that is you're purchasing a cell phone, along with the cell phone, what we are doing, we are purchasing the Bluetooth devices, we are purchasing the earphones, we are purchasing the cover or the case for that particular cell phone, we are purchasing the different cases for that particular phone, and accordingly, the phone is also been decorated and it has also been protected. So what we are doing, we are looking for a joint or composite demand. The main product, main commodity of that particular product of that particular purchase was the your cell phone, and along with the cell phone, different accessories are been associated. You are purchasing a laptop, no? What is your need? Your need or your demand for this particular product was to just use Word, Excel, PowerPoint. And for this particular concern, you need just a laptop. But along with laptop, what we are doing, there are several joint or composite products that have been associated. First thing, the laptop bag,
the laptop cover, the laptop case, the covering, the foil or the sheet for the coverage of the keyboard, the mouse, that is, you can purchase a mouse which is wireless or the with wire. You can purchase an external keyboard also. You can purchase external Bluetooth devices. You can purchase external speakers and so on. So it is an example of a joint or composite demand. Direct or indirect demand. Direct or indirect demand, wherein the demand for a particular product may be direct for an individual, or it may be created by some another person. Now, for example, you are purchasing a particular product which has been directly related to you. Now, for example, we as an educational institution, or you as a particular student. Now, a particular person or a particular employee who is related with the manufacturing industry, what is his requirement? That is a direct requirement. He will be needing proper shoes. He will be requiring a particular uniform. If you are working on the field, then accordingly you will be requiring sunglasses, you will be requiring cap, you will be requiring the apron and so on. So accordingly, this is the concept of direct demand. Indirect demand, that is by the word of mouth or by the listening to different people. By watching to certain different people, you may feel that I need to purchase this particular product, and accordingly, I may use this particular product. So at this, for example, a particular teacher, now whenever he is teaching in a particular classroom, he may use a spectacle or he may not use a particular spectacle, that is glasses. So for the protection of the eyes from the screen, what we are doing, certain teachers are using glasses and certain teachers are not using these particular glasses. So it may be a type of a direct demand or an indirect demand. So for protecting a certain commodity, for protecting a certain goods, we use that particular product or we do not use that particular product. A particular doctor may use hand gloves or he may not use that particular hand gloves also. So a type of a direct demand or an indirect demand. A particular consumption of the medicines. Now, whenever you see that you want to, whenever you have a certain fever, we may directly go for a paracetamol or a particular crocin, or you may refer for different product which will be suggested by your physician or that particular doctor. So accordingly, what do? We go for a direct demand or we go for an indirect demand. That is, if I know I want to purchase crocin, then accordingly, I may directly place order for the specific product, or I may go to my physician and I can consult him for an indirect product or a indirect material or the other product that he is suggesting for. Total market or the segmented market. Now, total market demand or segmented market demand product is a type of demand wherein all the customers, the public at large, are demanding this particular type of product. Now, what are the different types of product? First one, that is the example of today itself. That is, everyone is in need, everyone is in demand for purchasing of face mask. So what we are doing, every single customer, every single person, every single individual, he is going to the particular market and he is demanding that particular product. So at this stage, this particular type of product, this particular type of commodity, which has been demanded by maximum number of people, that is public at large, that is 1 crore, 2 crore, 5 crore, 10 crore, 50 crore people, if they are purchasing the product, entire market, entire segment is purchasing your product, then this particular type of product or this particular type of demand is called as a total market demand or segmented market demand. Okay, any difficulty at this stage for any student? You can please ask me the questions.
Durable or non-durable?
Durable and non-durable. So durable product are those particular type of product which can be remaining for over a longer period of time, and non-durable are this particular type of product which cannot be remaining for a longer period of time. For example, purchase of an umbrella, purchase of an food articles, or purchase of an almari, that is a particular cupboard. Now, cupboard we do not purchase on a daily basis. If you once purchase a cupboard today, that cupboard may be affordable, that cupboard may be durable for around 6 months, 1 year, 2 years. Or your furniture, we do not change or we do not alter our furniture very oftenly. We change our furniture for every 2 years, 5 years and so on. But whereas in case of food commodity, daily basis, we need certain different types of products for our consumption. So accordingly, as per our need, as per our requirement, as per our demand, we start changing the consumption of these particular products or commodities. So this is the concept of durable and non-durable. Any other?
Thank you, sir.
Yes, welcome. Okay, I am dropping the link of attendance in the chat box. Students to please mark their attendance accordingly.